Everyone, we're happy to have Agnieszka Bicy talking about all loop structures in supergravity. So take it away.
So thank you. Thanks a lot for giving me the opportunity to present this piece of work here with you. So I'm going to discuss some structures that you can find in supergravity. So what I'm going to discuss is based mostly on these two papers that appear, one in February and the other one just last month, with Giulia Fardelli, who is my PhD student at Uppsala, and Alessandro Gorgudis, who is a postdoc now at TNS, and actually is also applying, so keep an eye this year on him. Okay, so what I'm going to discuss, so what I'm going to achieve is to understand better the unitarity structure of supergravity on a DS5 cross S5, and in particular how the amplitudes behave at all loops in the Newton coupling. The way in which I'm going to do this is by applying some conformal bootstrap technique to get information on the amplitudes, which in general they are hard to access with more conventional amplitude techniques, for which with conventional amplitude techniques I mean Feynman diagram in general. So why did we think of doing this? We thought of doing that because this method of using the conformal field theory techniques to extract this information has been very successful at one loop, and actually few groups that you find it listed here managed to recover from the CFT data to compute completely the one loop amplitude that you see in the picture here. So the follow-up question that we had was, how can we do that at all loops? So is there something that we can say about all loop amplitudes? So let me start by quickly reminding a few things about ADS-CFT. It's not because I think you don't know them, it's just to set up a bit the notation. So the setup I'm going to use is the ADS-CFT in its original formulation, which relates four-dimensional SUN n equal 4 super young Mills, where SUN is the gauge group, at large n and a large lambda. So I'm studying the ADS-CFT correspondent in the supergravity limit, where lambda is g square young Mills times n, where g is the coupling constant of the young Mills theory. And this theory is related to type 2b supergravity on ADS5 cross S5. Here I put the parameters. So in particular, lambda is, so if we think about an expansion in lambda, we are expanding essentially in alpha prime. So stringy correction to the supergravity will be determined by lambda, while we are thinking of having again a large n. So let's try to understand. So what are the observables that I'm going to consider? On one hand, there are correlation functions in the n equal 4 theory. And on the other hand, those correlation functions are dual to the scattering amplitude in ADS5 cross S5. In particular, the operators I'm going to consider are operators, which I denote by OP, which are half BPS operator of dimension P, which are protected, and they transform under the 0p0 representation of SU4 R symmetry. And those kind of operators are dual to Kaluza-Klein modes on the string, on the scattering amplitude, if we think of them being external states in scattering amplitudes. Now, in particular, I will focus on a specific operator, which is exactly the same as you see on the first line, where P is equal to 2. And this operator is a scalar operator, which is the super conformal primary operator of the stress tensor supermultiplet, which is dual, this supermultiplet, to the graviton supermultiplet. So that's why we are essentially interested in this, in the correlation function of this operator, because we would like at the end to give some information about scattering amplitudes of gravitons. Now, let me just quickly show you the strategy that we are going to use. So the strategy is essentially that we are going to consider in this green in this green box, you see the CFT approach, then we are going to take a flat space limit to compare to the amplitude, and then we will see essentially what we can say in this regime, and then which kind of lesson can we learn by doing this flat space comparison. Here you also see in the blue box some Mellin space approach. I won't have time, unfortunately, to discuss that, but I wanted to keep that there because I think it is very interesting, and maybe we can discuss about that either over Slack or in some other place. Okay, let me start by studying this green blob here. So let's take the four-point function of these operators, these O2 operators. So conformal symmetry just fixes for us the form of this operator. And in particular, we see that the four-point function is given by a function of UMV, where UMV are just the usual cross ratios, over x1 2 to the 4, x3 4 to the 4. Actually, this four-point function can be written as the sum over all the possible representation which appear in the tensor product of the two 20 prime, because remember that each operator transform under the 0 to 0. So in particular, if we take the operator product expansion of the two operators, you see that there are six representations under which this intermediate operator can transform. Now we are going to use the supersymmetry, and in particular we are going to use superconformal word identities. Superconformal word identities actually imposes very strong constraints on these functions GR here, and actually what they do, they essentially dictate algebraic relations among all these six GRs. And at the end of the day, all the six functions can be written in terms of only a single function, which I called FUV here. So instead of having six functions, we only care about only one function. And this is actually only a consequence of the superconformal word identities. So supersymmetry fixes for us this structure. So now we can do much more by using even more the supersymmetry. So before doing that, let's use the conformal block decomposition. So we can decompose our function FUV in terms of conformal blocks. So the G, delta, and L are the conformal block associated to primaries of dimension delta and spin L. And here in this diagram, I just show you that essentially we are, oh, sorry, I forgot a sum. There should be a sum over delta and L in front. And this A on the first line is just the square of this three-point function here. But now we are going, as I said, this was just to set a bit the notation, we are going to use supersymmetry even more to classify which kind of intermediate operators we have. So we have two classes of intermediate operators. And one class is operators which are short and semi-short. What does that mean? It means that essentially these intermediate operators either belong to short or semi-short representation of the superconformal group. And in particular, what it matters much for us is the fact that the three-point function of the form that you see there, so where two operators are this half UPS that I said before, and one is this short and semi-short, is protected, meaning that it doesn't get any correction in lambda, this lambda that I said at the beginning, and also the dimension of these operators is protected. So this class of operator is very interesting because if you go back to this equation here, you see that essentially A delta L can be computed, so we know, and delta and L we know, so essentially we can perform this sum. And the second class of operators are operators belonging to long multiplets. In this case, both A and delta are generic, so essentially they have they can depend on any function of lambda. So here is essentially what I said. So this G short is nothing but the sum that I showed you previously. And as you see, G short depends only on the conformal block and on the rank of the gauge group N. So it cannot depend on lambda because it only repacks the contribution of short operators, which are protected. While this curly H is generically also a function of lambda because it takes into account the contribution of long operators. So now, okay, this is what I said. So the short is computable while H is not computable. And this is what we are interested in actually. So the remaining part of my talk is essentially related to this function H. Now, again, we are going to use supersymmetry because we would like to decompose this function H into superconformal blocks. Why do we want to do that? Because we would like even more to single out information from this H, and we want to reduce the set of operators which appear in this sum. So as you see here, in this new sum, I wrote a sum over delta NL where the sum runs only on the superconformal primaries, which again are long. And this G tilde is nothing but the superconformal blocks, which we know the structure. I didn't write it here not to clutter much. But again, so let's keep in mind that now the whole problem that we said at the beginning, so this four-point function of four half BPS operator is reduced to the study of this function H. Now, as I said at the beginning, we would like to study our conformal field theory function in an expansion in N, for large N and for large lambda. In this talk, I'm specifying to the leading order in lambda, so only the first order, while for n, we take all orders. So we have to think of expanding our h, a tilde, and delta at all orders in n, but only leading order in lambda. So here I wrote the expansions that I have in mind. And I wanted to single out the leading contribution from the remaining one, because I wanted to mention one fact, which is very important in what I'm going to discuss later, is the fact that all the intermediate operators in this regime, which is essentially the supergravity regime, are either double trace, at least up to order n to the minus 4, or higher trace at higher order, because the single trace unprotected operator are essentially decoupled from the theory. So as intermediate operator, we only have double trace or higher. So you see, actually, because the leading term is 4 plus 2n plus L, which is essentially the double trace. Okay, let's go further and let's look for a second at the one loop example. By one loop, I mean the one that I showed you previously, which is 1 over n to the 4. Let me mention a couple of caveats which are very important in this business. So the first caveat is that there is a mixing problem to be solved, which means that there are different operators, with operators, I mean the intermediate operators, which have the same bare dimension. So this means that we need to solve this mixing problem. This mixing problem actually has been solved. So there is no problem at order below n to the minus 4. And also another important point is that once we know the A0 and gamma 1, where this index I now denotes the degeneracy, it is possible to reconstruct fully the one loop answer, which is the 1 over n to the 4 answer. I don't have time, unfortunately, to explain how to do, but trust me that there are several CFT techniques which allow to reconstruct completely this amplitude. Now I want to show you a picture to show how you do diagrammatically this kind of reconstruction. So on the left hand side, you see the one loop box. So you see that the fact that we have here this mixing problem to be solved means that we have to introduce all these mixed four-point functions that you see on the right-hand side, the mixed green and blue. So this is essentially a reminiscent fact of this mixing problem. So you see that if you cut, you make this green cut here, you see that we have to sum over a product of two trees, where actually the four-point function is different from the previous one. So we have to take the sum of all these products of these two different four-point functions. This will be a key point also later. So it is true that we have to make a product of two trees, but two different trees from the one that we are starting with, because we have this degeneracy. Now, let's go to the main point. So look at this formula. This is actually present. It is a term which is present at any order in perturbation theory, like n to the minus 2k. And you see that actually this term here, we can completely, we know already completely, because this is fully determined by only three level data, meaning a tilde 0 and gamma 1, because this we already know by studying the leading term. Now, the main question that, so this is essentially what I said. So the main question that we wanted to ask is to which kind of terms in the amplitude these terms correspond to? Indeed, there are few caveats. The first caveat, which is maybe for people that already know these things, but okay. This, while for the one loop, we A0 and gamma 1 were enough to reconstruct the full box, here we are sure that it is not possible to reconstruct the full amplitude, because essentially in order to reconstruct the full box, we need to compute the full double discontinuity, and here we don't have enough ingredients. So unless k is equal to 2, we are not surely able to reconstruct the full amplitude. But what can we do? And also, yes, this is a bit redundant, but we have intermediate operators, which are also Hager trace in the game. So how do we want to proceed? The way we are going to proceed is to take a limit in the correlator, which corresponds to flat space in the amplitude side, which means focusing on the bulk point limit. And the sums that I show you before, these sums here, so you see here that we have to compute a sum over I, N, and L, which is generically a kind of complicated sum, in the flat space becomes simpler, and now we can also compare our results to the 10-dimensional 4-graviton superamplitude in flat space. And we did that, so I will show you a two-loop example. So you see that here we have the first term, so Gn is related to the rank of the gauge group in this way that you see here. We have this kind of structure. So we have the full Gn, Gn square, and Gn cube. So where you see that there are also non-planar diagrams appearing. Now, in order to match this with the conformal field theory side, we need to reduce to fine dimension and compute the discontinuities, which again, for two loops, we can write it in this way. So we have these two cuts. And as you can see, the cut in C1 is this double trace cut, while the cut in C2 is a triple trace cut. So it is clear that we want to reproduce the C2 cut completely, because as we said, we are only taking into account the fact that at previous order, we only have double trace. But what can we compute? Quite strikingly, this term corresponds to iterated S-cuts. So if we take the flat space limit of the first line that you see in this slide, you recover completely this iterated S-cut of the full box. And we computed that for quite some order, and we checked that this is actually what we obtained. Now, this is very interesting, and this is a kind of unitarity cut that we managed to perform at any order in N, essentially. So for any loop order in this kind of supergravity amplitudes. So now, as a result, I would like again to say that we computed this iterated S-cut in flat space, but we believe that this is also valid in curved space. Indeed, proving that is a bit more complicated, and in particular, we use some tricks to make this connection between our sums in flat space and the amplitude, which we cannot really use anymore. So we would need to perform the full sums. But we believe that since the SCFT is true also in curved space, we believe that this should be also valid. So there are, I listed here a few open problems just to discuss maybe. And so one, let's say, easy thing is to include this lambda correction that I mentioned at the beginning, which is, I guess, is only a technical problem. While another problem is to resum this contribution that come from all these cuts. So as I said, we know that at any order in N, but can we, do we manage to resum it? It is not clear that we manage or not. Another thing is to understand better the singularity structure. This would allow us to understand better the singularities that we have in the supergravity action. So we don't have any understanding so far, but I guess that these steps would allow us to understand better what happens at higher ends. And again, this is the last point, is I already explained a bit. So try to match these iterated cuts with away from flat space, so in the real curved space, but we don't have much to report on that. So thank you very much.
Thanks so much. And let's all thanks Agnesa for this great talk.
Thank you.
Let's see if there are any questions. While we're waiting for questions, let me ask a question. Are you only cutting, like in the, when you say cuts in the S channel, why are you not cutting with a curved line, or why are you only using straight cuts? If you go back to your previous slide.
Yeah, so essentially what we are doing, we are taking this propagator, we are cutting the propagators there. So here, okay, the point is supersymmetry, I think the answer to your question. So we are considering we are considering operators which belong to the graviton supermultiplet. So, but we are taking the scalar representative of them. So that's why we cut in this way.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. We have a question from Chia Xian.
Yeah, so thanks for a nice talk. So just maybe a naive question. So how is the iterated S cut here compared with the Regi limit?
Okay, that's an interesting question. So in principle, I think if we manage to, the Regi limit is a bit non-perturbative. So in principle here, we are doing a strongly perturbative computation. I think if we manage to resum all these cuts, we could also probe the Regi limit here. So they are related, but not at this point, I think. Order by order in perturbation theory, we cannot really make a comparison with the Regi limit.
Maybe if you can use that reversely, say from Regi limit, we can expand perturbatively order by order and see how that compares with your result.
Yes, this could be something that we can do. I'm not sure if the non-perturbative effect will be big and we would see that, but yes, this actually can be done, I guess. Yes.
Thank you.
So are there any other questions before we go on? If not, let's thank Agnesa once more.
Thank you.